والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. All praise is due to Allah, and may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and upon all those who follow his footsteps, who follow his sunnah, who follow his way, his methodology, his creed, until the last day. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Today, inshallah ta'ala's presentation is entitled Getting the Best Out of Salah. Getting the Best Out of Salah. Now, today, inshallah ta'ala, I want to focus on the mental, physical, and spiritual preparation for the second pillar of Islam, as-salah. As you know, Islam is built upon five pillars: shahada, salah, zakah, Sawm Ramadan, and Hajj. And Salah is the backbone of this deen. It's the backbone of this religion. And Salah is the most consistent act of worship out of all the acts of worship that were obligated upon the Muslims. And what's interesting to note about Salah is that it's the first obligation in Islam. I mean, after our belief, I mean, it is obligatory to have the belief, the shahada, declaring and believing that there is only one God worthy of worship, and that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But of all the acts of worship, whether it be zakat or hajj or siyam or any other duty that we have, salah was the first act of worship that was legislated for the Muslims, or upon the Muslims. And we also learn from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that the first action that will be judged upon on the Day of Judgment is the Salah. Of all our deeds, the act that we will be judged upon is the Salah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that if the Salat is sound and if it is in good order, then so too will the rest of our actions be. Also, we find that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's departing legacy or words before he died were related to salah. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was on his deathbed and he was dying, he said, "As-salat, as-salat, wa ma malakat aymanukum." Salah, salah, and what your right hand possesses. So, also, what is interesting to note about Salat, and that exemplifies, that shows the importance of Salah, is that it is the only act of worship that was legislated above seven heavens. All other acts of worship were legislated on the earth. And Salat was not legislated through a mediator. I mean, the other acts of worship, they came through Jibril, Gabriel alayhi salam. Yet Salat was commanded, was given to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by a direct order from Allah azza wa jal, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is, all of these facts that we've mentioned right now are what shows the importance of the salah, and how important salah is, and how significant it is in Islam. And salah, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is a link. It is your link between you and your Creator, between you and Allah Azza wa Jal. If there's no salah, there's no link. And that's why if you want Allah to speak to you, then read the Qur'an. Allah Azza wa Jal is addressing us. But when you want to talk to Allah Azza wa Jal, you pray. Because in the salah, you are saying, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. You are saying, you alone we worship, and in you we are seeking aid and support and help. So salat is a link between you and between Allah Azza wa Jal. Just as, for example, in this day and age, we link up with one another through, for example, a phone, whether it be a mobile phone or a landline phone. The phone is a link between me and somebody else. No phone, very hard to establish that link. And likewise with the salah. The salah is that link between human beings and between the Creator, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Today, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the problem is not in the number of those who are praying. Alhamdulillah, we have many Muslims who are praying. Muslims who are praying in the masajid, who are praying at home, who are praying in the park, on the plane, on a ship. Okay, Muslims are praying everywhere. And you see this on the internet, you see so many beautiful pictures of people praying in so many different, subhanAllah, in so many different and beautiful places, fulfilling their duties. And this is why Allah subhanahu, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that the ard, that the earth is a masjid. That means it's a place of prayer. That wherever you are, you can pray. I mean, of course, there are some exclusions. You know, you're not allowed to pray in the bathroom, you know, toilets. You can't pray, for example, in a graveyard. And certain other places that have been mentioned. But generally speaking, when a Muslim wants to pray, a Muslim is not limited to a place of worship, as were some of the scriptures of the past, being limited to maybe their synagogues and what have you. Now, a Muslim has his place of purification wherever he goes, and he has his place of prayer wherever he goes. So even if you don't have water, you can perform tayammum, which is a dry ablution. So alhamdulillah, wherever we are, there's no excuse not to be praying. I mean, unless, you know, you're a woman, okay, and you have your period or your menses, then of course that is an excuse. But for men, there is no excuse not to be praying. There is no excuse not to be praying. Unless, of course, you have slept through the prayer or you have forgotten the prayer. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that when you do forget a prayer or you sleep through a prayer, that you should pray it as soon as you remember it. مَنْ نَامَ عَنْ صَلَاتٍ أَوْ نَسِيَهَا فَلْيُصَلِّهَا إِذَا ذَكَرَهَا. You should pray it as soon as you remember the prayer. And not delay the prayer as some people do, because some people, they delay it to the next prayer, or they delay it to the next day. And this is wrong. So, alhamdulillah, there are many people who are praying. And today we are addressing those people who are praying. As for those who are not praying, then this is a very severe act of sin that they are committing by not praying. But today, let's not focus on those individuals, but let us focus on those who are praying. And today, as I said, the problem is not so much how many Muslims are praying. Alhamdulillah, a lot of Muslims are praying, but the issue that we have is, unfortunately, not many people are maximizing their rewards and the returns that Salah has to offer, the fruits of Salah. So my job today is to introduce the mental, physical, and spiritual aspects that can contribute to an outstanding prayer, not just a normal prayer. Because we're praying five times a day, we want to ensure that our prayer is perfected, that we want to perfect our prayer. And inshallah ta'ala, I want to share 25 ingredients or 25 factors and contributors towards a successful salah, inshallah ta'ala. Now, of course, we have to always keep in mind the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam found in Sahih Bukhari, who said, "Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli." Pray as you have seen me praying. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he set the example through his actions and through his words as to how to perfect our salah. So, inshallah ta'ala, in light of this hadith, صَلُّ كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِ أُصَلِّ, I want to speak about those important aspects that will help you perfect the salah. And when we're talking about perfecting the salah here, we're talking about khushu'. Khushu'. Khushu' is translated as humility and attentiveness and tranquility in the salah. So it's a number of things. It's about having concentration, concentrating on your words and your actions, and not allowing for your mind to derail and to drift and to wander. So it's about having that attentiveness. So khushu' isn't just about, it's about being humble in your salah, attentiveness, as I said, humility. So yes, you know, we know about sujood. You know, sujood is when you are in a state of prostration. So sujood is in a when you are in a state of prostration. But what we want in the salah is not only when we come to sujood that we are in a state of prostration, you know, prostrating on the seven bones that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanded us to prostrate on. But there is khushu', and there is khushu' can be displayed in that our eyes are performing sujood. Our heart is in sujood, and every single limb of our body is in this state of sujood, whereby we are submitting ourselves, surrendering ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He talks about the importance of khushu' in salah in Surah Al-Mu'minun. In Surah Al-Mu'minun, which is the 23rd chapter of the Quran, from the onset, from the very beginning of the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَدَ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Successful are the believers. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions a number of characteristics and a number of traits that make a believer successful. And the first thing that He mentioned from amongst the characteristics that make a believer successful, He says, الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Those who have khushu' in their salah. Those who during their prayer are submissive. Khushu'. Now what's interesting, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on and He mentions some more characteristics. And before mentioning the reward of possessing those characteristics, He seals it off. Before the reward, He says, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَوَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ. Those who are carefully maintaining their prayers. And then He gives the reward, and He says, أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْوَارِثُونَ. They will be the inheritors. That they will be those who inherit. Inherit what? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the next ayah, الَّذِينَ يَرِثُونَ الْفِرْدَوْسَ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. Those who inherit al-firdaus. Al-firdaus is the highest level of Jannah. So Allah begins by mentioning the salah as the first characteristic. He seals it off with salah, and He tells us what the reward is. So khushu' is very, very important to be يعني maintained from the beginning of the salat right through to the end. From the takbir until the taslim. From the moment we do takbiratul ihram and we say Allahu Akbar, that there is khushu', that there is this submissiveness and there is this humility and attentiveness in the salah until the very end of the salah, until we say assalamu alaikum, until the taslim. So khushu' to the salah, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is like the spirit. It is like the ruh to the body, or it's like the heart to the body. How important is your heart? If your heart stops, you die. Without a heart, you cannot live. So this is khushu' to the salah is like the heart to the body, or like the head to the rest of the body. And we know how important our head is. So without them, the body is useless. Now also what we have to keep in mind, brothers and sisters in Islam, is that khushu' is not a switch that we can just, you know, turn it on and turn it off. Okay, it's time to have khushu', we just hit the switch. Hit the khushu' switch. You know, and switch it on. And then when we're finished, just switch it back off. It doesn't work that way. But there needs to be actions that will develop khushu'. that will enhance khushu' and that will help us maintain the khushu'. And when it comes to khushu' in salah, there are things that will help us have khushu' in the salah even before you approach your salah. So the environment. Before you approach the salah. And there are things that you can do just before you actually pray. And there are things that you can do within the salah. So the environment, approaching the salah, and in the salah. So there are factors that are all connected to help us يعني, have an outstanding salah. Right? However, today, inshallah ta'ala, my installment and my presentation is about prior to the salah. What can we do prior to the salah to ensure having khushu' within the salah? Just prior. And inshallah ta'ala, in another presentation, we will have the factors that and the things that we can do within the salah that can help us, inshallah ta'ala, achieve and maintain that khushu'. So let me, inshallah ta'ala, introduce 25 elements, 25 ingredients towards an outstanding and successful salah. Especially given that salah is the first thing that we will be questioned about on the Day of Judgment. This is why this is a very important topic, a very important lecture, inshallah ta'ala. Now, it goes without saying, and this isn't number one, because it goes without saying that to have the right intention, the niyyah. Although I haven't included that as part of the 25 points. So the first point really, it goes without saying, as I said, is to have the intention, to have the sincerity, to have the ikhlas. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Say, قُلْ إِنَّ say my salat. قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي my nusuk, my rituals. وَمَحْيَايَ and my life and my mamat and my death are all for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to always remember that if we want the fruits of our actions, the fruits of our actions are dependent on the sincerity. The more sincerity that we have, the more ikhlas, the better the niyyah is, then the better the outcome is going to be. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that actions are built upon and are based upon the intentions. So let's get started with number one. The first important factor, as I said to you, is the environment. And so we have to ensure that we get our hearts used to Islamic environments that will nurture our iman. Because when your iman is high, when you have an iman rush or you have a high level of iman, this will actually help you with regards to your khushu'. And the storehouse of your iman is your heart. So if your heart is filled with corruption, if your heart is filled with corruption, then anything you try and pour in it of that is beneficial will spill over. I mean, think about this analogy. Imagine you have a cup, and it's a filled cup, and you try to pour anything in it. It's going to spill over. Right? So you have to empty it. So this is why when it comes to our hearts, we have to empty them from evil, from sinister and bad thoughts and ideas and corruption and beliefs and all those things, whether it's jealousy, whether it's envy. So, and this is where the ulama, they have this term, التخلية قبل التحلية, that we need to empty out our hearts, detoxify them, cleanse them, purify them, and then fill them up with the good stuff. We don't want to have a mixture of corruption and goodness within the heart. So, التخلية قبل التحلية. So we detoxify our hearts. You know, many people today are detoxifying their bodies. You know, that one study shows that, for example, one of the reasons why many people are overweight today and are obese is because their bodies are very toxic. And when we remove toxins from our bodies and we get rid of this, the bad stuff from our body will behave in a better way. And likewise, the heart. The heart needs to be detoxified and the heart needs to be purified, especially that it's the storehouse out of our iman and our yaqeen and our ikhlas on all those beautiful things that Islam has taught us. And the Islamic environment is very important. And by that I mean by who do you associate with? Who are your friends? And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the hadith, he said, لا تصاحب إلا مؤمن. Do not befriend or have as your close buddy, your close companion, except a believer. To have a mu'min, to have a believer as your close buddy. لا تصاحب إلا مؤمن. So it also means, where do you spend your time? You know, the places. So your associates and the places, the environments that you place yourself in. That's very, very important. And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, he said, the wolf devours the lone sheep. The wolf will attack a sheep when it's by itself. But when it is in a flock, okay, the wolf doesn't attack. And that's why we have to make sure that we are always in an Islamic environment whereby we are reminded. We are reminded just by the appearances of Muslims. We are reminded through the structures, whether it be the masajid and the Muslim organizations. Okay? We are reminded by individuals through their words, through lectures and through presentations and through the Jumu'ah prayers that we attend to. So the environment plays a very important role. And there are many, unfortunately, Muslims who live, you know, in very remote areas where there are no Muslims. It's very important to be in good Islamic environments. And in the hadith, you know, the story about the man who killed 100 people. And, you know, when he was directed to that knowledgeable person, he was told to go to an environment, to leave the country we had killed, or the city that he had killed 100 people, and to go to an environment where there were Muslims, and to worship Allah with them. So you can see the importance of environment and how important that is. So iman, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is nurtured and watered through righteous actions. Your iman can be pumped, and it will grow when you do righteous deeds, when you pray sunnah prayers, when you give sadaqah, when you perform umrah, when you give a charity of any sort, your iman grows. And Islam teaches us, and Ahlul Sunnah teaches us, that al-imanu yazidu bi-ta'a, that iman increases with ta'a, with obedience, and it decreases with disobedience. And then when you disobey Allah Azza wa Jal, your iman decreases. So how are we going to fuel our iman? We're going to fuel it with the environment, the people that we associate with, the places, and our very own actions and keeping away from sinful deeds, inshallah ta'ala. So this is the first point. We move on to number two, inshallah ta'ala, and that is to stay away from sins and environments that cultivate sins. So we want to keep away from sins and environments that cultivate sins and transgression, or whereby, you know, environments that lead to transgressing the limits of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in Surah Shura, verse 30, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَمَا أَصَابَكُم مِّن مُصِيبَةٍ فَبِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ وَيَعْفُ عَنْ كَثِيرٍ. That whatever of misfortune befalls you is due to what your own hands have earned. And he pardons much. So again, if we're not gaining much out of our salah, then we're doing something outside of our salah which is wrong. And one of our pious predecessors, one of us, a salaf salih, he spoke about how he was deprived. How he was deprived of performing night prayers for 6 months. That for 6 months he did not have the ability to perform night prayers as a result of a sin that he had committed. He had committed some sin, and as a result of that sin, he said, I found it very difficult to pray the night prayers. So again, let us always remember that sins are destructive in this life before the next life. The third factor that can contribute to khushu' inshaAllah ta'ala is thinking about and learning about the virtues and learning about the rewards of salah. What are the virtues of salah? What is so rewarding about salah? What are the advantages of khushu'? What are the advantages of salah? When you start to now understand why you are praying and the benefits of prayer, then that will be a motivation for you to pray better. And just to share a few things with you, we have to understand that salah actually makes you happier and it helps you maintain your iman. And it's your iman that's going to save you from the hellfire. It's your iman that will help you to enter Jannah. And in Surah Al-Baqarah, in the 153 or the 153rd verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَةِ. He addresses the believers. And he says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَةِ. He said, seek help. Get your help through patience. Being patient and salah. You want help? Then do it through these two. These are two fundamentals, two very important ingredients. Again, now salah is like also a daily stop. You know, we have different stops that Islam has given us to help us rejuvenate our iman and to save us from punishment in this life and punishment and in the hereafter. And you may have heard one of my previous lectures, Ramadan, stop, revive, survive. So Allah, just as Ramadan is a yearly stop that we stop to revive our iman, a daily stop would be, our daily stops would be salah. Subhanallah, we work, and then, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from His mercy, has prescribed salah at different times of the day, at different points. It's like different stations that we stop at. We perform wudu, and when we are performing wudu, what happens? We are, invigorating our bodies. We are refreshing ourselves. We are feeling, inshallah, better and more awake and alert through the wudu. And then through the salat, through the tranquility of the salat and the spiritual feeling that salat offers us. Islam is a faith of spirituality. Many people in a day and age where many people are looking for spirituality. Many people are looking at ways of being, spiritually enhanced and feeling better about themselves. Islam offers that. And Islam particularly offers that through the five daily prayers. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. And it helps us, subhanAllah, realign our focus. We find, for example, that, throughout the day we are taken up by materialism. We're working to earn a dollar, to earn so much and to have so much. But salat gives us the reality that it's not just about this life. It realigns our focus that the real purpose of life is to worship Allah, is for me to get to the hereafter. Salat helps us to focus on the akhirah, to focus on the afterlife, inshaAllah ta'ala. In the hadith which is found in Sahih Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam informs us that salat cleanses our sins or purifies us from sins. And he gives us an analogy. And in this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to the Sahaba, he said, look, if there was a river at the doorstep of any one of you, and you bathed in it, and you had a bath in it, five times a day, would there be any traces of filth on you or dirt on you? And the Sahaba, they said, no, there will be no traces of dirt on you. And so the Prophet ﷺ, he said, that is the example of the five prayers. That is the example of the five prayers which Allah blots out. Which Allah blots out your evil deeds, your bad deeds. Also, from amongst the virtues of salah, as we read in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "As-salawatu al-khams," the five prayers, "wal-jumu'atu ila al-jumu'ah," from one Friday prayer to the next Friday prayer, Kafaratun, it's a kafara, it's an atonement, an expiation, a wiping away of the sins lima baynahun, that you commit between them, between the five prayers and between Jumu'ah and Jumu'ah. Ma lam tukhsha al-kaba'ir, as long as you avoid major sins. So as long as you are avoiding major sins, Allah is wiping away all those minor sins through the salah. Also, if a person is after the protection of Allah Azza wa Jal, we read in the hadith which is found in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, man salla as-subha fahuwa fi dhimmatillah, that whoever prays the subh, whoever prays the subh prayer in jama'ah, if you pray the fajr prayer in jama'ah, that you will be, that you will have the protection of Allah Azza wa Jal for that day. So look at how much salah offers you. Now when you start to think about all these virtues, you're going to try and make your salat, you know, outstanding. Not just a normal salah. And also we learn that salah, it saves us from entering into sin and shameful deeds. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Inna salata tanha anil fahsha'i wal munkar." That salah prevents a person from doing fahsha, from doing shameful deeds, and munkar, or evil deeds, or unjust deeds. That's another virtue of salah that we need to think about. Another virtue of salah, that when we pray the 12 sunnah prayers in the day, that are associated with the fard prayers, two before the fajr, four before the dhuhr, two after the dhuhr, two after maghrib, two after isha, that totals 12. If you pray 12 units of sunnah prayers in a day, Allah Azza wa Jal builds for you a mansion in Jannah. And this hadith is found in Sahih Muslim. Also we read in the Sunan, in the hadith books of Sunan, such as Abu Dawood and Tirmidhi and others, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that if you pray four units of sunnah prayer before dhuhr, and four units of sunnah prayer after dhuhr, after the fard prayer of dhuhr, then Allah forbids his flesh from the fire. Allah forbids your flesh from the hellfire. So again, adhering to this sunnah. And in the hadith which is found in Sahih Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, "Man salla al-bardayni dakhala al-jannah." That whoever prays the bardain, bard means cold, the two cold prayers. And the ulama said that here the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is referring to the fajr prayer and the asr prayer. The fajr prayer is the coldest time that we pray a prayer. And likewise, asr is when that period of the day where it's cooler, right? And fajr prayer, we know people find it very difficult to get up for the fajr prayer. And asr prayer, well, people are usually quite, you know, busy and occupied trying to wrap up things with their work and their money and collecting it. And so it's a real test. So if you are going to put the dunya aside, and put your desires aside for fajr and asr, and you are always safeguarding those prayers, then you are guaranteeing for yourself Jannah. Man salla al-bardayni dakhala Jannah, and the hadith is found in Sahih Bukhari. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whenever he was frustrated and he was in an anxious state, he would flee to the salah. You know, in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, kana idha hazabahu amrun fazi'a ila salat. Whenever something was worrying him, he would flee to the salat. And as I said, because salat gives you that spiritual enhancement, it gives you that happiness. So again, when we need to think about the rewards of the salat. And we need to understand also, as per the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that when you pray, that he said a slave may pray and have nothing rewarded for the salat except for a tenth. You might get out of your salat only a tenth of the reward, or a ninth of the reward, or an eighth of the reward, or a seventh, or a sixth, or a fifth, or a quarter, or a third, or a half. He mentioned in exactly like this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So not everybody's salat is rewarded 10 out of 10, or 100%. It goes back to your level of hushoo, your concentration, how you are praying. Are you praying in light of the words, صَلُّ كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي, pray as you have seen me praying. This is something that you need to reflect upon. The third factor is to perfect your wudu. Part of the khushu' process prior is to perfect your wudu, perfecting your wudu. And the key to salat is your wudu. Allah Azza wa Jal does not accept salah without wudu. And unless there is a situation whereby you just cannot perform wudu, and this would be a case of necessity or need, or you know, you're in dire strait, you know. So in the hadith which is found in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, there is no Muslim who, when the time for a prescribed prayer comes, does wudu properly, has the proper attitude of khushu' and bows properly, but it will be an expiation for all his previous sins, so long as they were not major sins. And that is the case for life. What a beautiful hadith. But let's perfect our wudu. And if you are feeling, for example, if you come to the salah and you're feeling, you know, really lethargic and you're feeling lazy and you feel you're not going to concentrate in the salah, even if you have wudu already from a previous salah, then there's no harm in redoing your wudu. Wudu on wudu is no problem, inshallah ta'ala. Number 5, purifying your mouth with siwak or toothpaste. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he recommended that before we pray, and that when at the time of wudu and at the time of salah, to actually brush our teeth. And you can even brush your tongue where a lot of germs are lying. And we see this in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لَوْلَا أَنْ أَشُقَّ عَلَى أُمَّتِي, had I not found a burden, a mashaqqa on my ummah, on my people, لَأَمَرْتُهُمْ بِالسِّوَاكِ, I would have commanded them to perform siwak, which is brushing your teeth, عند كل صلاة, or مع كل وضوء, or كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام, at every wudu or every salah. So the importance of freshening your breath and cleaning your teeth, this is something which is very important. So again, that way, you feel that you are now going to be speaking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That you are going to be speaking His words. Number 6, wearing your best and your cleanest clothes. Again, when we approach the salah, let us, you know, have our best appearances. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-A'raf, in the 7th chapter of the Quran, verse 31, He says, خُذُوا زِينَتَكُمْ عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدٍ. He said, take your zina. He said, O children of Adam, Ya Bani Adam. He said, take your adornment while praying. So again, we beautify ourselves when we come to stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deserving of our adornment? How come that when we have meetings with other people, people of the dunya who are prominent figures or important people, we dress very well and we make sure we're appropriately dressed, yet when we are standing before Allah Azza wa Jal, we don't maybe dress properly. You know, we have to ensure that our awrah is covered. Number 7 is not praying in a garment that has decorations or writings or bright colors or pictures that would distract the worshipper. In the hadith which is found in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet ﷺ, he stood up to pray wearing a checkered shirt and he looked at the patterns in it. And when he had finished his prayer, he said, take this shirt. He said, take this shirt to Abu Jahm. Take it to Abu Jahm and bring me, and he said to bring him another garment that had no decorations. He said, because it distracted me while I was praying. It distracted me while I was praying. So again, choosing the right clothing so that way you're not distracted by colors and by lines and by decorations, etc. Number 8. Praying away from distractions and things that adversely affect your khushu'. In the hadith which is found in Sahih Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we find he said to Aisha, Aisha had decorated a wall with a colorful curtain. She had a colorful curtain up that she used to cover the side of her house. And he said to her, take it away from me, because its decorations keep distracting me when I pray. And I think that also applies to certain prayer mats. You know, there are some prayer mats, you know, that have so much, you know, decorations and patterns, or, you know, masajid, and really distracts you. You start to think about, you know, those prints and that decoration that's on there. So that's why when you are investing in a prayer mat, invest in a very plain one. Get a very plain prayer mat. Don't get one filled with decorations. Very important, inshallah ta'ala, to remember this. Avoiding things that could afford, as you said, distractions and things that could adversely affect your khushu'. You know, sometimes we have a choice if we're at home to pray in certain areas. Don't pray in a room that's very cold. Don't pray in a room that's very hot. Okay? We learn from the sunnah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would actually delay the dhuhr prayer if it was extremely hot. If it was extremely hot, he would delay the dhuhr prayer. Why? The importance of khushu'. Because imagine you're praying in that, you know, in a very hot place, a very hot time. What are you going to be thinking about? When's this, you know, when am I going to end my salat? I'm too hot, I'm too bothered, I'm too frustrated. So again, some planning, inshallah ta'ala. Number 9, not praying when there is food prepared that one wants to eat. And number 10 is not praying when one needs to answer the call of nature. Now I'll answer both of these in one hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لا صلاة بحضرة الطعام ولا وهو يدافعه الأخبثان. There should be no prayer that is performed when the food is served. If dinner is served, lunch is served, okay? You shouldn't pray if the food has been served. لا صلاة بحضرة الطعام ولا وهو يدافعه الأخبثان. And not when you need to attend to the call of nature. You know, you need to go to the toilet, to go to the lavatory, okay? So if you are in that state, you shouldn't pray, because you're going to be thinking about what? About your food, about the drink. You know, you're going to be thinking about, well, can't wait to leave my salat and to go to the toilet. You know, so again, very important. These are things that affect your khushu'. Now, also number 11 is to pray on time. Praying on time. And that will help you with your khushu'. Otherwise, if you're not praying on time, and you're going to be feeling in your salat, you're going to feel, I'm not praying on time, I feel guilty. You know, that sense of guilt will overwhelm you. That will affect your khushu'. And that's how shaitan works in many different ways to affect and to attack your khushu'. So again, choose suitable work that does not conflict with the times of the salat. Okay? And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He warned against those who delay their prayers. فَوَيْنٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ سَاهُونَ وَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ. Woe to those who are praying. Or wail is said to be a valley in the hellfire. For those who delay their prayers. Don't delay your prayer. And that's why the most beloved action to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is prayer on time. That's why when Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what is the most beloved act of worship to Allah? He said, As-salatu ala waqtiha. That you pray at the fixed times. Now, inna as-salata, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, inna as-salata kanat ala al-mu'minina kitaban mawquta. That salah has been prescribed upon believers at fixed times. We shouldn't delay salah. Shouldn't delay it. And we need to remember that the main purpose, yani, of life is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when it comes to our work, we should revolve our work around our deen and our duties towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not the other way around. So our salah has a priority. We need to be praying in workplaces that will allow us to pray, that will ensure that we pray on time. You know, recently one company in the world, they sacked their workers. A big company, a well-known company without mentioning it. Okay, it sacked their workers, you know, because they were taking, time off for their prayers. And the Muslims, alhamdulillah, you know, we're not going to compromise on their salat. So, again, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I have not created the jinn, and I have not created the jinn and mankind except to worship me. We have to remember to get our priorities right. We are here to worship Allah Azza wa Jal. We are here and we are, you know, riddled with trials and tests and tribulations and hardships and things that we have in our life, and we shouldn't lose focus. Number 12, pace yourself so you don't come to prayer in a flustered or agitated state. Many people, they come to Salat and they're huffing and they're puffing and they're exhausted, you know, and by the time they come to the masjid, they've come in a, you know, racing, Allahu Akbar, okay, and they're going, you know, where's your khushu? Where's the khushu? So again, very important to come, you know, pace yourself. And this applies to many things in life. You know, it's better to come early than to come on time. Better to come early than to be right on time. First of all, always allow for yourself. Allow for there to be a buffer for things to go wrong. And this wallah, this nasiha, this advice is not only for your salah, it's for everything in life. You know, there's one saying that I learned, if you're not early, you're late. If you're not early, you're late. Okay? Another saying, if you fail to plan, you plan to fail. So therefore, it is very important that we plan for our salat. That we plan for our salat. And when you come late to something, what happens, subhanAllah? And this happens, and take this as a general principle, that when you are late, you find that your whole day is rushed and late. Because it has this ripple effect. It just carries on to other things. It affects other things. You find yourself racing. So that's why. But when you're on time, you find you have time. You enjoy the moment. You enjoy things, the act that you were doing. In the hadith found in Sahih Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, do not make haste for the prayer. And whenever you come for the prayer, you should come with calmness. And pray whatever you catch with the people. And complete the rest which you have missed. So, very important that we don't come in a rush state. Number 13, that will help you, your khushu' is to pray in jama'ah. To pray in congregation. And that also, subhanAllah ta'ala, is very, and a very important point. When you're praying in jama'ah, you find there's more khushu' as opposed to praying by yourself. And again, as I mentioned earlier, the wolf devours the lone sheep. And that's how shaitan works. Shaitan attacks you when you're by yourself. But when you're with your Muslim brothers around you, you find that your iman is higher. And that you find that you are charged up. So shaitan has very little impact on Muslims when they're working together. Number 14, from amongst the things that can help khushu' if you're praying in the masjid, okay, is to ensure, when you're praying in jama'ah, to ensure that the rows of the salat are straight and that you are standing close together, shoulder to shoulder, feet to the feet. Making the rows, you know, straight and solid without any gaps, because as you know, the shaitan, he comes in through the gaps and in the rows. That's why the imam says, suddul khalali, close up the gaps. You know, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know, would say, sawu sufufakum. Straighten your lines. And the Prophet ﷺ would ensure that the lines of the salat are straight. And subhanAllah, how amazing it is. You know, there was a picture once shown to a non-Muslim of the haram in Mecca. And, you know, around the haram, people everywhere. You know, women, men, young, old, here, there. And, you know, and the time for prayer comes. And you know, when the time for prayer comes, everyone has to be in, you know, in rows, in circular rows, you know, very straight. And subhanAllah, you know, and we find that by the time, in this non-Muslim, when he showed this picture, he said, how long do you think it will take for these lines to be assembled and to get all these people to be, you know, standing straight? Because it will take, you know, probably a few hours. Because it just takes for the imam to say, stow. You know, straighten up your lines. And within moments, you just find, subhanAllah, the rows are straight. Islam is a religion of discipline as well. It disciplines us. We pray towards one direction. We pray together. We pray in rows. We pray, you know, subhanAllah, look at how Islam and the teachings of Islam are so beautiful. It has covered all aspects of our lives. And this discipline helps us in becoming disciplined also outside of our salat. Number 15 is to pray the sunnah prayers that come before the fard, as these prayers act as warm-ups for the fard. SubhanAllah, don't you notice how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated some sunnah prayers before the salat and some sunnah prayers after the salat, after the fard? Why? The sunnah prayers that are before the salat are like warm-ups, like the two, for example, before fajr. We know that the fajr fard prayer is very important. And we are usually very sleepy by the time we're going to come to the fard, which is important. So now, by the time we now make wudu, and we pray the sunnah prayer, when it comes to the fard prayer, what's going to happen? We're going to find we are so ready for the fard prayer. So there are warm-ups. And just like we warm up in exercise, before we get right into the match, or into the game, or into the activity that we're going to do, Allah Azza wa Jalla gives us warm-ups. And actually in one hadith, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, between every adhan and iqamah, a person can pray 2 units of prayer. They're like nafil, they're like sunnah, supererogatory, optional. So it's good to get into the habit of praying sunnah prayer before. As for those sunnah prayers that happen after the fard prayer, those prayers are to make up for our shortcomings within our salat of fard. So they patch up and they cover up for our shortcomings in the fard prayer. From amongst the contributors of the khushu' is to pray in the masjid. Praying in the masjid is the best place to gain your khushu'. Women are exempt. Women don't have to pray in the masjid. And the best place for a woman to pray is in her home and in her room. And again, when you're in an environment, the environment will help you with your khushu'. I mean, think about it this way. For those of you who do exercise, it's not the same when you do exercise by yourself, is it? When you exercise by yourself, you don't get as much out, say for example, as exercising in a gym or in a designated area for exercising around other people. So likewise, when you are praying in the masjid, yani, it has that impact, it has an impact on your spiritual body more so than you praying in your home. So again, the importance of the praying in the masajid of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Number 17. Repeating the words of adhan after the muadhin. So again, this is just prior to the salah, that you're getting yourself ready, that you're repeating after the muadhin. You know, the muadhin says, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. You say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. You know, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. You repeat after him, except when it comes to the hayya ala tain. He says, hayya ala salah, you say, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. When he says, hayya ala al-falah, you say, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Okay, so again, and then contemplating those words. Think about the adhan. Think about the words. When the muadhin says, Hayya ala salah, come to salah. What does that mean? Come, you know, Hayya ala salah, which means come to salah. Hayya ala al-falah, come to success. This means that salat brings you success. Okay, so if salat is going to bring me success, I'm going to perfect my salat. I'm going to pray an outstanding prayer because I know that salat brings me happiness. It brings me success in this life. It brings me success in the hereafter. And also, what is beautiful about the adhan, after the adhan, there are certain things you can say. As soon as the muadhin says, La ilaha illallah, the sunnah is actually to say, Wa ana ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. وَأَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. Or actually, it's an actual dua. And you'll find it actually in the fortress of the Muslim. Those of you who have fortress of the Muslim, and you look for the adhkar or what to say after hearing the adhan, in dua number 23, وَأَنَا أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهِ وَأَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ رَضِيتُ بِاللَّهِ رَبَّا وَبِمُحَمَّدٍ رَسُولًا وَبِالْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا. This is one of the things. A lot of people don't know about this sunnah. A lot of people don't know that as soon as the muezzin says La ilaha illallah, that you say Wa ana ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah. وَأَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ رَضِيتُ بِاللَّهِ رَبَّا وَبِمُحَمَّدٍ رَسُولًا وَبِالْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا. And then you send peace and blessings upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. Kama salaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim. Innaka hamidun majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. Kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim. Innaka hamidun majid. And then there's also the dua that will guarantee you, inshallah ta'ala, or that will earn you the shafa'ah, the intercession of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma rabba hadhihi al-da'wati al-tamma wa salati al-qa'ima. Aati Muhammadan al-wasilata wal-fadila wab'athhu Allahumma aw wab'athhu maqaman mahmoodan al-ladhi wa'adtah. And then there's an addition, as some ulama have agreed upon, which is innaka la tukhifu al-mi'ad, or saying it without it. So there are different things that you can say. And if you say this, you are, inshallah ta'ala, securing for yourself the shafa'ah, the intercession of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Number 18, pronouncing the dua to be recited after the adhan, as we mentioned that, that will help you. Number 19, reciting dua between the adhan and the iqamah. Dua between the adhan and the iqamah. Again, you're putting yourself into that state. That state of being tranquil and submissive and humility. Okay? Because dua, and you can make specific dua to, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps you with your khushu'. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he encouraged us to seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from a heart that does not have khushu'. وَمِنْ قَلْبٍ لَا يَخْشَى اللَّهُمَّ إِنِّي أَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْ عِلْمٍ لَا يَنْفَى وَمِنْ قَلْبٍ لَا يَخْشَى. You know, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you a sound heart, a steadfast heart. Number 20, remembering death. Remembering death. In your salah. This could be your last prayer. Think about how many people have died, they are in the grave. How much would they love to come out of their grave and pray 2 units? Alhamdulillah, we're alive right now. We can pray 2 units and we can pray more and we can perfect them. So let us not take for granted the life and the breath that we have. And so we find, for example, in As-Silsilatu As-Sahihah for Shaykh Al-Albani, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, remember death in your prayer. For the one who remembers death during his prayer is bound to pray properly. And pray the prayer of a man who does not think that he will pray any other prayer. وَصَلُّوا صَلَاةَ مُوَدِّعَ. The Prophet ﷺ, he said this once. He didn't say it all the time. But he said, pray the prayer of the one who is bidding farewell. That's it. It's the last prayer. Pray it with khushu'. Every prayer should be prayed as if it is the last prayer that we're ever going to pray on the face of this earth. Number 21, learn the meanings of all the phrases pronounced throughout the salah. What does it mean? Subhana Rabbi al-Azim. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. التحيات لله والصلوات والطيبات. What does it mean? إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. Who are the ضالين? Learn these phrases, especially that we are saying them all the time, the main phrases. Learn them, because then you can actually focus on what you are saying and your mind doesn't drift. Inshallah ta'ala. Number 22, learn the meanings of all the Quranic chapters that you'll be reciting in your prayer. So let's say you've memorized Al-Fatiha, which you must know for salah because it's a rukn, it's a pillar of the salah. And you always are in the habit of saying, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ and قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ إِنَّ أَعْطَنَكَ الْكَوْثَرِ. What do these things mean? What does kawthar mean? What does khannas mean? You know, so again, contemplating the Qur'an and pondering over the Qur'an. Also, what will help you with your khushu' is if you learn different chapters. So that way you can mix and match in the salat after Al-Fatiha. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to sometimes, you know, recite this surah and that surah. So the Prophet was not in the habit of always saying one surah after Al-Fatiha. This is something to keep in mind also. Number 24 is to pray with a sutra. When you come to pray, pray with a barrier or a partition that is in front of you, very close to you. It's called sutra. Even if it's a wall, if it's a tree, even if a person is just sitting there. Okay? That will help you with your khushu'. And then hadith found in Sunan Abi Dawood, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, when one of you prays, let him pray facing a sutra, and let him get close to it. And in another hadith found in Sunan Abi Dawood, he said, when any of you prays facing a sutra, let him get close to it so that the shaitan cannot interrupt his prayer. And Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah, he mentioned three benefits of the sutra. He said, first of all, the wisdom of it is that it helps you to lower your gaze and not look beyond it. So when you have a sutra there, your eyes won't wander everywhere. So your eyesight is fixed to just a limited space and area. And secondly, to prevent anyone from passing in front of you. You know, if someone's going to come and pass in front of you, they won't come and pass in front of you and they'll see the sutra is there and it won't affect your khushu'. And also, he said it prevents the shaitan from passing in front of you and trying to corrupt your prayer. The last, inshallah ta'ala, ingredient or element or factor that will help you, inshallah ta'ala, with regards to perfecting your prayer is to think about the examples of those who perfected their prayer or who were perfecting their prayer from amongst our pious predecessors. There's lots of stories that you can read and learn about how those who prayed before us at the time of the Prophet ﷺ and beyond prayed, perfecting their prayers. And one person that comes to mind, one of the Sahabi radiallahu anhu wa arda, is Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. SubhanAllah, when the time for Salah came, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, he would be visibly shaken and the color of his face would change when the time for Salah came. He would actually be shaken. And it would be said to him, you know, what's wrong? And he would say, by Allah, there has come to me the time of amanah, the time of trust, which Allah offered to the heavens and the earth and the mountains, but they declined it. They declined to bear it, and I as a human being bore it. And he's referring here to the ayah of Surah Al-Ahzab, the 33rd chapter of the Quran, verse 72. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Inna aradna al-amanata ala al-samawati wal-ardi wal-jibal." فَأَبَيْنَا أَنْ يَحْمِلْنَهَا وَأَشْفَقْنَا مِنْهَا وَحَمَلَهَا الْإِنسَانِ إِنَّهُ كَانَ ظَلُومًا جَهُولًا. In conclusion, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, be patient. Have sabr. As I said, khushu' is not a switch. You don't just turn it on and off. There are factors that contribute towards the khushu' based on the environment that you put yourself in as a Muslim, based on what you do leading up to the salah, and based on what you're going to do within the salah. And wallahi, when you perfect your salah, when you perfect your salah, you will end up feeling that the best moments of your life are when you are with your Rabb, that when you are with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the energy and to help us to perfect our prayers, to help us enhance and to perfect khushu' within our salat and within all of our acts of worship. هذا والله أعلم وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد.